how COVID-19 may impact private property transaction, definitely volume will drop by a lot. So I thought what I'll do today is just look at some of the past transaction data during three previous crises: Asian financial crisis, during the SARS period, as well as during the global financial crisis. Hey guys, my name is Mike Cho from Urban Zoom. Welcome to another episode of Data Stories. Today's date is actually 7th April 2020, the first day of this whole circuit break situation because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Right now, I'm at my home trying to tidy up as much as possible. Usually it's very messy. But I thought during this period where all of us are kind of staying at home, what I'll do is try to make all these videos where I will try to talk through data and carry some stories around the data. You know, obviously I'm a geek and I love this stuff, but I do think that there are usually some very interesting stories that one can tell by looking at some data, and that will give us some idea of what has actually happened in the past, and that hopefully give us some ideas of what might happen in the future. Over the coming days, I'm hoping to do it every day, if not once every 2 days if I can, and I'll be talking through all the numbers. Yeah, not necessarily just on real estate, actually, any numbers that I can get about Singapore. I always thought that it's great for people who don't like to look at this stuff, but you know, some of these insights or stories, these are all stories that deserve to be told, and I'm hoping to do it on more regular basis now that I'm so-called stuck at home. So anyway, the first thing I want to talk about is basically how COVID-19 may impact private property transaction or private property market in Singapore. To begin, let me just show you this chart. This chart actually is showing the monthly transactions for private transactions in Singapore. So the top part is actually showing you new sale. The bottom part is actually showing you resale. And it's going back from early 2017 to March, right? End of March of this year. I want to focus just on the first quarter of every year, from January to March, right? And what I want to highlight here is whether it's new sale or resale, you often see a pretty significant increase from February to March numbers. Presumably because, you know, February, maybe it's a Chinese New Year period or whatnot, but you really usually see this increase, whether it's in new sale or resale, 2017, 2018, 2019. In fact, some earlier years, most of the early years, in fact, it would be very, very hard to find a year where March is less than February. Now look at what is happening this year. New sale, we have a pretty productive so-called month for new sale. Maybe you can explain that away, why there's a big drop in March for new sale, but certainly for resale, you can see that there's a drop. I think that is just pointing, you know, of the things to come in the coming months. So in order to study the future, perhaps I think it's quite instructive to look at what actually happened in the past. So I thought what I'll do today is just look at some of the past transaction data during three previous crises: Asian financial crisis, during the SARS period, as well as during the global financial crisis. But before I get into all that, right, I do want to just quickly talk about the difference between new sale and resale, and why, in my opinion, for this kind of analysis, I prefer to just look at resale. So this is a chart for new sale transaction, the two, again, the one on top is just showing you the number of transaction, monthly transaction, but they are color-coded by specific projects. And then the second row, what you see is the number of projects where there are actually a transaction for that month. So for instance, just in March, you see that there's close to 1,000 transactions, and there's maybe just about 70 unique projects, new launch projects that actually see transactions. The reason why I don't like to use new sale numbers for this kind of analysis is the following, right? If you, let's say, look at February, right? February is quite clear. You see a pretty healthy numbers, right, for February, at least in terms of number of transactions, but really is mainly driven by two pretty significant launch. One is Park Canberra, the other being the M. Imagine if there's no launches like those, the numbers would be way worse. Not only that, right? I mean, when you do things like looking at the median price or the average price or things like that, right? You can imagine big launches for that particular month can completely swing the numbers. Now, it doesn't happen for resale. So these are the resale number, and you don't see the same thing happening for resale. You know, every single month you look into them, right? You don't see any big block of single color, which means no single project actually have an outsized contribution to the numbers for that month. And on top of that, every single month you have way more number of projects being transacted, right? Compared to new launch, right? So usually new launch is anywhere between 50 to 100 per month, new launch projects being transacted. For resale, the numbers could easily be anywhere between, you know, close to 400 all the way to close to 800. So that's why I typically like to look at just resale numbers for this kind of analysis. So the chart for resale, right? Transactions all the way starting from 1995 to today on a monthly basis. And on top is basically showing you the median price on a per square foot basis. You can see that actually the volume really do, in terms of transactions, actually they do move through very big swings over time. The place where I want to focus on, like I said before, is I want to talk about what happened during Asian financial crisis, what happened during SARS period, what happened during the global financial crisis, so that we can have some idea of what could potentially happen this time around. So So let's dive in. Asian financial crisis. Here I'm plotting from July 1997 for the following 2.5 years or so. On top, I'm basically plotting the median price per square foot, but I'm actually marking everything on 100% basis from the first day, right? So this is to give you an idea what is the percentage drop and, you know, how long does it take to recover. 2nd July 1997, that's when the Thailand government actually have to float the Thai baht, you know, because they couldn't support the currency peg to US dollar anymore. I won't go into the detail of why, but basically it was just bad, right? Not just for Thailand, but for a lot of Asian countries, including Singapore. And so this is what happened since that day, right? Straight away, what you see is that the number of monthly transactions has really dropped. It dropped from close to 300 transactions per month all the way down just over 100 transactions in a month. So you're really talking about easily more than 50% drop in terms of volume. Correspondingly, actually, the prices kind of stay put for a little while, for a couple of months, but it start to really drop from the fourth quarter of 1997. And in fact, when transaction volume start to pick up, you know, starting from the first quarter or maybe March or April period in the following year, in 1998, while transactions start to pick up, actually prices keep dropping. The price didn't really stabilize until a full year plus into it, right? Sometime in October 1998, so a year and maybe a couple of months, the median price in the resale market at least has dropped a pretty significant, you know, number, about 35% from the base in the market, median price in the market. But what you see is actually a return to volume. The volume was only dropped by maybe in three quarters, you know, by the fourth quarter since the crisis, actually the volume has picked up again. In fact, it really picked into high gear, you know, toward end of 1998 and all the way to 1999. And that's when you start seeing some recovery in prices. I think it's not until maybe sometime like end of 1999 before prices start to, at least the median price start to crawl back to what it used to be when the crisis first started. So anyway, that's Asian financial crisis. Transaction volume in immediate drop, prices follow quite soon after that, but it really continued going down even as transaction volume picked up. So that's the learning. I mean, at least that's the observation from Asian financial crisis. So what happened during SARS? SARS, actually, it was a much shorter episode. What happened then was that I think in February, if I'm not wrong, Hong Kong actually had the first reported case. And then shortly after that, I think in early March, Singapore has its first reported case as well. But frankly, by May the same year, which is literally just 2-3 months after that, I believe the WHO has already lifted Singapore from the infected country list. So really, it's just a, you know, really, really short crisis. Indeed, if you look at the actual numbers here, I plotted it from February 2003. And you can see that the prices, I mean, they moved, but I mean, it's not significant enough for me to say that, oh, it was a strong move. I would say these are within the margin of error. And again, we're looking at median prices. The volume never really so-called dropped. It's still pretty steady, you know, holding about 300-400. In fact, more, like actually once after June or May, end of May, when there's better clarity that we have this thing under control, you know, the volume did actually picked up, you know, a fair bit, right? Rise all the way above 600 in July. And the prices, if you look at the median prices, always stay around the same, you know, slightly lower, maybe a little bit. I don't think it's that significant. So really SARS, at least if you looked at it from the perspective of the resale private property transactions or private property market, it was almost like a non-event. How about global financial crisis? I myself started work a lot long before the global financial crisis, so I remember this very well. I plotted this chart from March 2008. I took that as a starting point. I mean, there are bad news already before that, but I took March as a starting point because I think that was when Bear Stearns was kind of bailed out. So I think the Federal Reserve had to facilitate the sale, buyer sale, I think, to JP Morgan. And that's when people start to wake up a little bit. Oh, you know, a big name can kind of go through a fire sale. And so that's when the bad news started coming. And in the private property market here, right, you can see that the volume, the monthly transaction volume, have been quite all right, actually, all the way towards the end of 2008. You know, Lehman Brothers, I think they went down in about the fourth quarter, I think October, if I'm not wrong, 2008, and September, October. That's when really everything went to shit, okay? It's quite an instant reaction in terms of transaction volume. And in fact, if you look at prices as well, right, the prices are actually dropped from 100% to say 86% ish in early 2009. So this kind of percentage drop, I think, is significant, you know, versus what had happened in SARS period. So this, you're talking about close to maybe 15%, you know, 14 to 15% drop in the median price per square foot in the resale market. What you saw is once we went past March 2009, I think because of all the support measures coming from the Federal Reserve, coming from all the stimulus package around the world, including in Singapore, you see a huge picked up in transaction volume, like really through the roof, right? This is in all the way to rest of 2009. And in fact, prices recover very, very quickly along with this volume. So it was a very healthy recovery backed by very strong volume. So in that sense, I mean, if I were to conclude, right, I mean, AFC was really bad. I mean, it dropped like 35% and it took like 2-3 years before the price prices really start to recover. Even though volumes start to recover early on, SARS is almost a non-episode. Global financial crisis was bad, but it was almost like a V-shaped recovery. How about COVID-19, right? So I plotted from January because I think that the first case started from January. But of course, you know, the world really started to sit up. Maybe not the world, at least the Asian countries, right? Including Singapore, started to really sit up when China put Wuhan in lockdown. And in subsequent months, you know, as we know, since all this is still very, very fresh in our memories and we're living currently in this situation right now, you see the volume had definitely started to drop. And like I mentioned at the very beginning of the video, typically March, what you expect is a higher number than February, right? So March should easily be doing close to 700, you know, a fair bit more than what we got in February, which is 600. But we didn't get that. Having said that, for prices, you know, it's mainly, you know, maintained. In fact, it went up a little bit, you know, but I won't read too much into it. So the question is, what may happen in the coming months? This is not a very, very scientific exercise, but my interpretation or my view currently is this. Definitely volume will drop by a lot, certainly this month, right? Because literally, I don't think the agent can do much. You cannot meet for viewings, and no viewings means no transactions. And even when all these measures are lifted, I think it's going to be lifted very, very gradually. It's going to take us a while for transaction volume, basically economic activity in this market, to start to pick up again. Having said that, I don't think prices is going to really drop all that much. We got to remember that in the past, say 5-6 years, you know, the Singapore market has been somewhat artificially cooled back because of all these cooling measures that the government has enacted, and which means that actually we are not in a bubble. I don't think certainly in the property market sector because of all these cooling measures. And so maybe unlike in previous episodes where right before the crisis, say global financial crisis or like even an Asian financial crisis where you have a pretty healthy spike, and it's hard to say whether it's in bubble territory, but at least before that things were well, right? But in this case, the last 5-6 years, I would argue that there's actually, you know, the market is pulled back. Because of that, right, it's very unlikely to find distressed seller, right? Most homeowners are going to be quite all right to sit this out, which means that for bargain hunters who want to come into the market and buy things on the cheap, you'll be hard pressed to find someone who's willing to sell you their property for cheap. Maybe the new sales is a little bit different. Maybe some of these developers might be under pressure because of the 5-year timeline that they need to meet. Maybe the government may relax it because given the current COVID-19 situation, we don't know. But certainly in the resale market, we'll see a lot less transactions, but probably prices will stay pretty stable. My own view on this whole situation, I know that this video is getting very long, but my view on this whole situation is actually I don't think we are going to see, or rather I'm not that hopeful that we will see a vaccine anytime soon actually, which is a lot of people are banging on it. I don't know. I mean, I'm not a biological, like, you know, healthcare expert, but I just don't think it will be that easy to create a vaccine that have very, very little negative side effect. It's available at volume, you know, throughout the whole world, right? And you kind of need the whole world to have this vaccine as well. No point you just have it. Some of the countries near you, you know, or like, you know, you interact with, they may not have it. This disease knows no border, right? As we've learned. So that is almost, you know, I actually place very little hope in that. However, I do think that this whole thing can turn around, at least in terms of the economy activities, when there are cheap testing at scale. Think of it like so cheap, like a thermometer that you buy, right? From say Watson. You buy and it, instead of thermometer, this is just a DIY testing kit that you can do every morning. You test yourself and then maybe you report the authorities and authorities will verify that and whatnot. And it gives you some kind of code so that, you know, because one of the main issue why all these economic activities have been pulled back, in my view, is because when you go for meetings, you don't know whether the fellow sitting across from you have the virus, and neither does he know, right? Because this virus is so crazy that you can have the virus and not show any symptom and yet be spreading. So really testing is the key at scale and at very, very low cost. I think if that can be done, and I think the chance of that happening is a lot higher to me than having a, you know, a good vaccine. If we can get those, then, you know, then at least the fear would be a lot more reduced. And once those fear are gone, then, you know, your risk appetite come back in the market. People start to go for meetings, you know, so long you show, hey, you know, I just test this morning, I'm okay, I'm negative, right? You're also negative, right? Okay, so let's talk business. I think that will be what is required for this to really remove the whole overhang around, you know, all the economies in the world. Anyway, that's just my view. Like I said, I mean, in the coming days, I'll be stuck at home, and what I want to do is to churn out this kind of videos on a daily basis if possible, not every other day. So if you are like me, you know, who like data and you like to look at numbers and you like to look at how the stories are coming from the numbers, you know, definitely subscribe. Or if you have interesting questions that you always want to find out about Singapore, it doesn't have to be just about property, you know. In fact, in future episodes, I'll probably talk about transport and other sectors. But if there are some interesting questions that you have that you would love to see some numbers around, feel free to leave your comment below and then I'll definitely reply you and then, you know, look through them. And if I can find data, probably make a short video on it. Anyway, thanks for watching. Stay safe and I'll see you in the next one.